This is the fourth event in our fall lecture series. We're extremely excited to have Emily Rogers on campus to talk with us today about growing with a purpose. And just to kind of give a brief introduction, Ms. Rogers, as a business consultant, executive coach, and retreat facilitator, Emily strategically advises and supports businesses, teams, and individuals in growing and realizing their full potential in purposeful and balanced ways. Emily is a sought-after speaker that has presented keynote presentations and workshops throughout North America, Europe, and Asia. In 2013, she joined the faculty of Polk State Corporate College as an adjunct instructor teaching leadership and development courses. Prior to starting her business in 2013, as President and Chief Growth Officer of IEG, she advised Fortune 100 brands, professional sports teams, entertainment properties, and global nonprofits on how to form mutually beneficial strategic alliances. As a volunteer leader, Emily serves on the board of directors for the United Way of Central Florida and the Polk Education Foundation. Previously, she served on the Florida Festival and Events Association Board of Directors and was board chair for 2 years, the Florida Education Foundation Board of Directors and Executive Committee, the Polk Museum of Art Board of Trustees and Executive Committee, and the Polk County SPCA Board of Directors and Executive Committee. Emily graduated from Florida State University with a bachelor's degree in elementary education and a master's degree in reading and language arts. She later earned a master's degree in educational leadership from the University of South Florida. Emily is a member of the Forbes Coaches Council, Lakeland Chamber of Commerce, Lakeland Economic Development Council, International Coach Federation, Institute of Coaching, Working Women of Tampa Bay, and Valley National Bank Women in Business. Please join me as we welcome Emily Rogers.
Emerging professionals in whatever field, I believe it's always important for us to be growing and to be purposeful about how we're growing, and that's different and unique to each of us individually. I'm going to share 10 guiding principles with you today, and my hope is at least one, maybe two, will resonate, and you'll take that with you today and carry that forward over the next few years as you are growing and developing with purpose in whatever ways that you are hoping to do that. So delighted to be here with you today. When I talk about this word purpose, I'm just curious to hear what comes to mind. This can be very interactive and engaging. Feel free to ask questions at any point. I'm really interested in hearing, when I talk about purpose, what comes to mind? Thank you.
A reason to live.
What was that?
A reason.
A reason. A reason. Ooh, I love that. Yeah, a reason. What else comes to mind? A plan. Okay, yep.
Being meaningful,
absolutely. Yeah.
Intention.
Yeah, these are all words that I love. Yeah. Anything else come to mind? Who feels connected to their purpose and where they're going in life? Oh, okay. We've got lots of hands. Wow, about half of the room. That's wonderful. I don't always see that. So that is tremendous. That means you're connected to what matters, and you're doing what matters to you and what's important to you. And because of that, you're probably making a tremendous impact in many ways, and will continue to do that in the future. So that's wonderful. So let's dive in. 10 guiding principles. I'll stop periodically for questions, comments. If you've got a burning question or comment you want to share, please stop me at any point. This is your time. I want you to get the most out of this over the next 30 to 45 minutes. So the first guiding principle, of course, is to have a compelling purpose. And it looks like about half of you are already there, which is wonderful to see. When we're connected to a compelling purpose, I believe that everything in life and work just gets easier, because then we know how to spend our time, how to spend our energy, how to use our talents and skills. And most importantly, we have a much better sense of what to say yes to and what to say no to, right? So I didn't get connected to this until about 10 years ago. As I kind of wandered my way through my career, starting my career as an elementary school teacher, then doing some public relations work for the citrus industry, then working in marketing in the fairgrounds, then doing marketing consulting in Chicago, and then finally starting my business, I really was just kind of wandering my way through my career. And I was using my skills and talents, but I wasn't being super purposeful about it. And once I got connected to my purpose about 10 years ago, it all began to become a little bit more clear about where I wanted to be and what I really wanted to be doing in life, which is this. And it took me a little while to get there, because I had this important job as president of a company in Chicago when I discovered all of this. And I began to take steps, small steps, to get closer and closer to this, where I am today. I've had my own consulting and coaching practice for 7 years now, and next year will be my 8th year, and I am truly, truly living my purpose. So what sparked this purpose in me? I was at a marketing conference, the Association of National Advertisers Marketing Conference, and Mark Pritchard, who is the Chief Marketing Officer of Procter & Gamble, was the keynote speaker, and he began to talk about how he got connected to his purpose through a book that he read by Richard Lyer called The Power of Purpose. I'm gonna mention several books, and I'm also going to summarize these on a slide at the end, so feel free to snap pictures of any of this, and that will be on that slide at the end. And will they get this presentation?
I can have access to it. That's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. They can have access to all of this. There's some additional quotes and things like that you want to hold on to. So there he was, the CMO of Procter & Gamble at this worldwide advertising conference, talking about his personal story about how he got connected to his purpose, and then how he took those same principles and applied them to his work at Procter & Gamble, and finding ways for Procter & Gamble brands like Tide and others to also have some sort of cause-related purpose in the brands and giving back in some way. So I got the book, and I read it, and I did a lot of journaling, and I realized that my purpose was really all about growth, creating growth in myself, and creating growth in others. So I began to look for ways to express that value of growth in my work and my life on a daily basis. Some days it was easier, some days it was harder. Some days I felt like I was getting closer to that, and other days I felt like I was way far off from that. And so for a couple of years, I just sort of played around with this idea of growth, and what does this mean for me personally and professionally, before I finally decided to take the leap and really focus on this work in this community, very purposefully in this community, by helping others grow and realize their full potential in purposeful and balanced ways, and in ways that are most meaningful to them and whatever they want to achieve in their life and their work. So with that, I'll leave you with a quote. To have great purpose to work for, a purpose larger than ourselves, is one of the secrets of making life significant. For then, the meaning and worth of the individual overflow his personal borders and survive his death. So when we get connected to purpose, it becomes about something bigger than us. It's about something bigger than a paycheck. It's about something bigger than the job title or whatever is on your business card. It's about what you're leaving as a legacy in whatever role that you're playing, and the value that you're bringing to others in the community that you operate in, and the people that you serve. That's what purpose is all about to me. When I'm coaching clients that are trying to discover how to connect to their purpose, we look at four things. first we look at what really lights you up. What are you interested in? You know, what are your hobbies? What, you know, what are the things that you just love to do? So we look at that. We look at skills and talents and background and the pieces and parts of that you might want to put to good use. We look at what does the world need, or what does your community need, or what are the people around you need? And then we look at, if we want our purpose to be connected to a job, what can we get paid well for that is also connected to our purpose? And I believe that when we are connected to the things that we're passionate about, the things that our world and the community around us needs, and we're able to utilize our skills and talents that we've built up probably over several years, and connect that to a job that we love, that is a wonderful place to be in life. And I hope that for all of you as we move forward. So the second guiding principle, once you get connected to that purpose, is to assess regularly. Am I still connected to this purpose? Does it need a little massaging? Do I need to revisit and reword some things? What's the meaning behind this? And am I getting closer to it, or am I getting farther from it? And what do I need to do to stay on the path, to stay connected to my purpose, living and breathing it every day in every role that I play in my life and my work as a parent, as a teacher, as a student, as an employee, as a member of the community? How am I doing in living my purpose? Is my purpose still engaging to me and others? Am I bringing value to others through my purpose? Am I still having fun? What's working, what's not working? And so I think it's really important to hit the pause button occasionally and say, how's it going, this thing called life, this thing called work, right? How is it going? Am I still excited? Am I still energized by the way that I'm spending my time and who I'm spending my time with? Are the things that I'm doing and the people that I'm surrounded by giving me energy or draining my energy? That's a really important thing to assess periodically. And when it's not fun and it's draining our energy and it's exhausting and depleting and we're overwhelmed, then it's time to make a change, right? And make an adjustment and redirect back toward that purpose or rediscover that purpose. I'll cover one more. So if you can't measure it, you can't improve it. So that's why pausing and assessing regularly is so important, so we know what needs to be improved. So third, and I'll pause for some questions. So when you're connected to your purpose, that doesn't mean that the things go well every single day, right? It doesn't mean that we don't make mistakes and have failures along the way, all right? So when you fail, it's so important to have the mindset that it's an opportunity to stop and reflect on what went wrong and why without blame or judgment of ourselves or others, which is really hard to do, to learn from it and to move on. It's part of life, it's part of work. Success is not a straight line, you know? We'd like to think that it is, because this would be really easy, right? It'd also be boring, too. So what success really looks like is all these twists and turns. When I think about all the twists and turns that I made in my career before I got connected to my purpose, before I made a commitment to myself to really living this purpose in a meaningful way for me and the community that I wanted to serve, I took all sorts of twists and turns and detours. But all those lessons that I learned along the way, the successes and more importantly the failures, I think that prepared me for what I'm doing today. And so that is so important to remember. When we do have a setback, when we do have a failure, when we do have a disappointment, when life and work gets hard, oftentimes it's preparing us for a bigger game that we're gonna play down the road. And I truly, truly believe that. So failure should be our teacher, not our undertaker. Failure is a delay, truly just a delay or a detour, not a defeat. It's a temporary detour, not a dead end. Failure is something we can avoid only by saying nothing we're not letting that go. Other comments? Yes.
A baseball player that can bat 300 is worth millions, but that baseball player that's worth millions fails 70% of the time at the plate.
I love that statistic.
When Thomas Edison was working diligently to invent the light bulb, after conducting 5,000 experiments, he was challenged by a young reporter that said, "Why do you keep going? You failed 5,000 times." Edison looked at the young reporter and he said, "Young man," he said, "you just don't understand the way life works. I have not failed 5,000 times. I have successfully identified 5,000 ways which will not work. It's just 5,000 ways closer to the one way that will work."
I love that. Yes. Yes. Yeah. What an empowering mindset. Yeah. He could have been set back 5,000 times, right? But he wasn't. He chose to learn from it. Yeah. Thank you. That's a great addition. Thank you. Other questions or comments?
I just think over the years, you learn and take something from everything that you do, and you incorporate it.
Yeah.
And I think the biggest piece of that is learning and growing and understanding.
Yeah. Yeah, and just being open to that. Yeah. Great. Thanks for having that. All right. So the fourth guiding principle, I believe it's so important for us to celebrate often. Celebrate when we're getting closer to that compelling purpose. Celebrate when we're living that compelling purpose. Celebrating the big wins and the big accomplishments, as well as the small wins. The small accomplishments. I come from a family of celebrators. My mom is one that loves to celebrate in big ways, and I'm just so grateful that she taught me this. Because I think that when we don't pause to do this, and we just stay focused on the next thing that we want to get to or the next thing we want to accomplish, we haven't paused to relish. Right? There's learning in celebration, right? So when we pause to celebrate and have gratitude for the things that we've been able to accomplish, or the ability for us to get closer to our purpose or live our core values, it's acknowledging that, yes, this is good, and celebrating the fact that you've gotten closer to that and that you've achieved something, even if it's small. I just think it's incredibly important to honor that in ourselves. So life is not about waiting for happy endings. It's all about treasuring small and simple moments of joy, celebrating as well as respecting small victories of overcoming limitations, struggles, and so on. Seek self-progression and be grateful for all the blessings, big or small, that life has offered or is offering you. So the next time you overcome a struggle, the next time you reach that goal that you've been working for, pause and find some way to honor that in yourself and celebrate that in yourself. I think it's just incredibly important. So next is tame your gremlins. So this one's always a fun one to talk about. And as I'm working with clients and I'm helping them get closer to their purpose in living and leading in alignment with their core values, oftentimes when we get connected to that core purpose and something that we really want to do or achieve or be, these gremlins start to come into play and start to tell us why we can't do something, or we're not good enough to do something, or we're not ready to do something. And so these voices in our head, these gremlins, come into play and begin to sabotage us and send us off track, right? And so it's so important as we're working towards a goal, as we are connecting to our core values, as we're trying to live our purpose in a meaningful way, it's so important to tame these voices that don't serve us, okay? There's a book called Positive Intelligence. It'll also be in the summary. And what I learned from that book is on any given day and on any given moment, consciously or unconsciously, we have thoughts that serve us and we have thoughts that sabotage us, right? And it's those gremlins that sabotage us, right? There's an assessment that you can do online, and I learned a lot from this assessment. I've done it several times over the last 8 to 10 years. And if you Google positive intelligence assessments, there's two assessments you can take. One, it measures the amount of time that you're living with those positive thoughts, consciously or unconsciously, and the amount of time you're living with those negative thoughts. So that is just really interesting, because my score for the positive thoughts the first time I took this thing was quite a bit lower than I thought it was going to be. And I thought, oh, there's something going on here, right? And I've got thoughts that just aren't serving me and where I'm trying to get in life and what I'm trying to accomplish. There's another survey on that same site that helps you understand and name these gremlins. There's 9 of them. And so what I learned when I did this is that, well, it reinforced what I already knew, that I'm a hyperachiever, right? And that's a good thing to some degree, but I can also drive myself and others crazy through hyperachievement. So I learned when it's necessary to dial that hyperachiever down in service to me and those that I'm serving, so I'm not driving myself and others over the edge. But I also learned I had a bit of a restless nature about me that I didn't realize. So that's one of those gremlins that gets identified in the survey. And that was causing me to, one, not pause and celebrate, because I was always looking for the next thing to accomplish. And two, it was causing me to lose focus and not stay on the things that were really most important to me. So it's a fascinating assessment. I encourage you to do it. The website is a wonderful resource. The book is a wonderful resource. And it just helps you get a better understanding of those thoughts, conscious and unconscious, that are going on in our heads that serve us and don't serve us. Really important. The only thing that's keeping you from getting what you want is the story you keep telling yourself. And that's really important to keep in mind. When you find yourself stuck, when you find yourself struggling more than usual, there's probably something going on with one or two of these gremlins that needs to be unpacked and discovered. So number 6 is mentoring and empower others. You know, so as we go through our career, hopefully we're fortunate enough to have strong mentors and coaches, because there are so many people in my life that have helped me get to where I am today. The people that served as cheerleaders for me, the people that guided me, the people that were there to answer questions that I had, and the people to give me a nudge when I needed that nudge, right? So important to have that, and so fulfilling when we find opportunities to give that back to others. Incredibly fulfilling. So there are times in our lives when we need this ourselves, and there are times in our lives when we have capacity to give this back to others. And it's a beautiful thing, and I encourage you to do it, because it makes all of us better and all of us stronger in many ways. So we rise by lifting others. So look for those opportunities to lift others on a regular basis. So 7, and I'll pause after this one for questions and comments. So wisely invest your time, talents, and resources. When we're clear about our purpose and what's most important in life, this becomes a lot easier. Otherwise, we're kind of distracted and scattered, and we're making choices that may not be in alignment. Once we're connected to purpose, it's much more clear about how we want to spend our time, who we want to spend our time on, how we want to use our energy and our talents and our resources that we have to share with others. So really important to be intentional about this. When we pause to assess on a regular basis, this is a really important thing to look at. Look at your calendar. How have you been spending your time? Who have you been spending time with? What have you been doing? How have you been expending your energy? Are you doing too much? Are you on overload? Do you need to find other things that are going to give you more energy versus deplete your energy? Incredibly important to be really mindful of this, because time is a precious commodity. You don't get more of it. There's only 24 hours in the day. core of that. And so it's so important for us to be mindful about how we're using our time and our energy, making sure we're taking care of ourselves while we're taking care of others, making sure we're doing things that honor the values that are most important to us and enable us to live our core purpose. So to have to decide what your highest priorities are and to have the courage, pleasantly, smilingly, non-apologetically, to say no to other things. And the way to do that is by having a bigger yes burning inside. So when we're connected to that yes and what we really want, it becomes easier to say no to the things that just don't fit, right? I think that's particularly important for the women in the room today. It's so hard sometimes to say no, because we want to be everything to everybody, and we forget to take care of ourselves while we're taking care of others. Yeah, I'm seeing some smiles there. So important, when we're connected to that yes, when we're connected to that purpose, it helps us know what to say no to and what just doesn't make sense in our lives anymore. And this will change over time. So I'll pause for questions. It's resonating at this point. Yes.
Kind of speaking to the celebrating of successes and the, I think it was like empowering others or whatever. I kind of noticed the other day, and this kind of resonated with me, I have little children, and we're so quick to celebrate the little things that they do because we want to encourage them when they're doing well.
Yes.
And sometimes even just, you know, putting your shoes away and getting a high five, their little faces will light up.
Yes.
Well, but that's a big deal for them.
It is.
So you never know what, you know, if people's perceptions are their realities. So what might seem like a small achievement to you really means something to somebody else. And
yes.
If you help them celebrate that,
yes.
You know, it's just, yes. Again, it's impactful.
It really,
so,
really
kind of
is.
Remember that as well.
Yes. Thank you for adding that. Positive intelligence. If you Google positive intelligence assessment, you'll get there. It's really interesting. It's really interesting. Yes.
To your 6 points you made there, the to empower and to mentor.
Yeah.
I've experienced several times out in the workplace where, you know, you might be trained to do a job, but then you're kind of left to kind of fall flat on your face afterwards.
Yep.
Because those people that have been there for a long time that have the knowledge almost feel insecure that you're going to take their place.
Yes.
But in reality,
yes.
you want to do that. You want to empower those people. You want to mentor them because they're your future.
Exactly
when you're no longer
right.
there, that's how your company's going to grow. So
that is
point
exactly
right there
right.
really resonates.
Yes. When I'm coaching executives, I call that distributing leadership, distributing knowledge, sharing knowledge. It's so important. It's impossible to grow and scale an organization without doing that. You've got to build the people up around you. You've got to give them the knowledge and the skills and the resources and the support, because you can't grow if you don't do that. Yeah. And, you know, sometimes it's hard for leaders to let that go because of that fear that you just described, that they'll be seen as not valuable anymore and not needed anymore. Yes. Was there another comment back here, question?
Could you give them some advice in getting into the workforce on how to find a mentor or how did you go about that?
Yeah, gosh, ask. Yeah, so sometimes it's somebody that is in the organization that you're working in, and oftentimes it's somebody outside of the organization. It might be a family member. It might be somebody that's part of a volunteer group that you're involved with. It might be somebody in your church. It might be a friend that just has a little bit more experience to share. So ask. In my experience, people are oftentimes willing to share. They want to share. When someone reaches out to me, especially some young professional reaches out to me and says, can we have a coffee? I'm like, yes. It might take us a month to get it on my calendar, but yes, I would love to do that for you. And so look for those people. They're there, I promise. And they're willing to share their time with you.
And when you get their attention, use it wisely. Go prepared with questions. Be ready with your questions. And I even advise my clients to send your mentors a few questions in advance. So they're prepared to kind of think about what you most want to know and are prepared to share really thoughtful responses with you. So find them, seek them out. They're there.
Okay, so number eight, step out of comfort zones that no longer serve you. Yeah, right? I would imagine for some of you that enrolled in Kaiser and began this journey, that you probably had to step into an uncomfortable zone to make that happen, right? You made a choice. And that choice involved doing something new, something you've never done before. And that choice also involved perhaps leaving something behind that was comfortable and known, but maybe not serving you and your family, right? So this is incredibly important. Coaches do a lot of work around this with clients because we all get stuck from time to time. And oftentimes when we're stuck, we find ourselves kind of wallowing in a comfort zone that just isn't serving us. And until we become aware of that, the thought pattern, the situation, the people we've surrounded ourselves by, the things we're telling ourselves, all of a sudden we realize, oh my goodness, this place that I'm in and the things that I'm thinking and the people that I'm surrounded by just really aren't serving me anymore. And yes, this is known and this is comfortable and it feels kind of sort of safe. In order for me to live my purpose and get to where I want to be, I've got to make a move that's going to require courage. And that can be hard, that can be scary. And when you graduate